Okay, so let's continue from what we had in the previous lecture, that is that we were talking about non-normalization theorems. And this is, I have to warn you that this may be the most difficult lecture of this whole course. Okay, so let's hope for the best and that we all survive after the 1 hour. Okay, good. So what I told you is that the whole Lagrangian, the whole action, depended on three arbitrary functions: k is real, w holomorphic, f holomorphic, and one constant, psi, which is the Fayet-Leopoulos constant. And then I told you that if you determine k, w, and f, then you determine the whole n equals to 1 supersymmetric Lagrangian. K gives you, for instance, the kinetic terms for scalars and fermions, and also their couplings to gauge fields. W gives you the Yukawa couplings and scalar potential. F is the gauge kinetic function that gives you the gauge coupling of the gauge superfields. And psi is just a constant that appears only when you have a U1 gauge theories. And so the issue that you have these general functions, and you say, well, if I determine each of them, all of them, then I know my whole Lagrangian. So then the question is how they behave under quantum corrections. And I told you I ended up on Friday telling you that K has corrections to all orders in perturbation theory, so K has nothing special. W is not corrected at all. F is only corrected at one loop. And psi, still a constant, is not corrected. So this is what I'm going to try to prove for you today. Okay. So, any questions before I start? No? Okay. So we can start with S equals integral d4x d4 theta of k as a function of phi daggers and e to the v, where I'm writing phi without indices, but in principle we can have many of them. Okay, so in principle this would be phi i's and phi I daggers, but I will put them at the moment and then I will get rid of them. Plus the Fayet-Leopoulos term times v, but v is the v for the u1s. So that's the real part of the action. And then the holomorphic part is just the superpotential only as a function of the chiral superfields. And then the gauge kinetic function, also holomorphic, times W alpha. W alpha. I'm writing this W is a bit different from that one, just to not confuse you, but it's just to make the point that they are completely different objects. Okay. Okay. To prove the non-normalization theorems, we will follow the following. We follow Seiberg. Which again, he followed Witten from string theory. (Clears throat) And we will write the action as follows. We will introduce the two fields, which are called Spurian fields, that will take care of the gauge kinetic function and the overall coupling in the superpotential. Actually, there are superfields X and Y, and they are chiral. So X will have components little x, psi x, and fx, and Y will have components little y, psi y, and fy. Have you seen this word before? Spurian. Good. Okay. So now you saw it. Mm-hmm. Okay. Spurian. S-P-U-R-I-O-N. I don't know what it means because in English, but it's just a field that you just just introduce. Spurious. Spurious. Like that. Yes. Yes. But it's a field. Spurian. So it sounds nice. Okay. Okay, so it is like a fake object. At the end, it will be similar to an auxiliary field in the sense that it will not propagate, but we will use it only to substitute, to take, to mimic something that happens actually in string theory. Probably some of you who are taking string theory lectures is that you know that in string theory, usually there are no arbitrary parameters. All the things in the Lagrangian, when you want to read, say, what is the Yukawa coupling or what is the gauge coupling and so on, they all have values of fields. They are not parameters that you put in by hand. The only thing that you have are fields, and the expectation values of those fields determine your different parameters in your theory. So it is in that spirit that we introduce the fields X and Y, so that their expectation values will determine the couplings, essentially. Okay. So in this regard, we write the Lagrangian again like a then I will introduce Y times W plus, and instead of F, we'll just introduce X times W alpha. Okay, so essentially Y and X are here. X is going to mimic the gauge coupling, and Y is telling you how essentially substituting Yukawa couplings and self-couplings of the matter fields by expectation values of Y. Okay, because this is the thing that tends interest to superpotential. In particular, if we set Y to be zero, we are killing all the couplings in the self-couplings among chiral superfields. Okay, that's the role that.
Are you missing an F?
Excuse me? Yes. Yes, I'm substituting the F, the whole F, by X. Actually, the proof, we could have just assumed that the Lagrangian is renormalizable. So then F, it was just a constant, because otherwise it would be non-normalizable. But I think we can extend the proof and include, just substitute F by X and X is taking care of the gauge coupling. So the expectation value of X gives you the gauge coupling. Very good. Okay. So to prove the non-normalization theorems, we will use the following properties. We will use three things. One, symmetries. Two, holomorphicity. And three, limits of x going to infinity, y goes to zero. Okay, this x going to infinity, remember, usually what you have here in front of the gauge kinetic term, you have a 1 over g square, 1 over the g square, where g is the coupling. So x going to infinity means gauge coupling to zero. And y goes to zero means all Yukawas and self-couplings to zero in the superpotential, okay? So these are the three elements that I will use in the next, and then try to prove the whole, all the non-normalization theorems. Okay, first of all, symmetries. What kind of symmetries do we have now in this Lagrangian? We have standard symmetries are supersymmetry and the gauge symmetry, so that's assume already, so it's already taken by for sure. But there are two new symmetries that I have by introducing the fields X and Y. So for symmetries, I have supersymmetry and gauge, which are already taken. But also, we have two new symmetries. One is an R symmetry. Remember that an R symmetry is a symmetry that does not commute with supersymmetry, something that I introduced when I described the basic algebra of supersymmetry. It's say, in the case of n equals to 1, it is a U1 symmetry, it's just a face, but that does not commute with supersymmetry. Not commuting with supersymmetry means that different elements of a multiplet have different charges under this U1 R symmetry. And you assign the charges to the superfield corresponding to the charge of the corresponding first component of the superfield. However, the important thing is that theta, the superfield coordinate, also transforms under this, under the R symmetry, because precisely theta's different elements of the superfield comes with different powers of theta. The field, the first term of a chiral superfield, it just has no thetas, the scalar. The fermion has one theta, and so on. The auxiliary field has two thetas, and so on. So each element, each field in a superfield transforms differently under the R symmetry, and therefore theta transforms. I can see a lot of confused faces, which is nice. Huh? That's a nice feeling. Okay, so let me just assign, and then you will get it more clear. So I have the fields, the phis, the v, then x, y, but I also have the theta, I'm sorry, and the w, alpha, so thetas, theta bar, and w alphas. Okay, so let's see which charges I assign to this. This has charge zero, and charge zero. So far, so very easy. So all the fields, they don't transform under that U1. So you can see already that the K is invariant because K depends on phis and Vs, and they don't have any charge, so K is invariant. X has charge zero. So this can pose a problem. You know, I'll tell you how. But let's see what happened to Y. Y, I will assign the charge, and this is arbitrary. Say it is two. I could have said any other number. It's a thing. So if Y has charge two, then I assign the charge minus one to theta, so that the scalar component of Y has charge two, the fermion component will have charge one because it comes to theta psi and so on. Okay. So theta bar has charge one again because it has the opposite charge of as theta. And W alpha, we have no choice. W alpha, we know that W alpha is not an independent superfield, but it comes from V. But remember that W alpha is a remember the definition of W alpha? It was D acting on V. Right? So only one was with bar, and the other one's without bar. And each D behaves like a theta, because derivatives and they include the thetas. And so W, you can check, and has charge equals to one. Okay, and now we can see why this is a symmetry. And why this assignment is a good assignment for a symmetry. As I told you, the thetas have to transform because it's an R symmetry, so that each component of a multiplet has to transform differently. But this d4 theta is a d2 theta times d2 theta bar. Since theta and theta bar transform in the opposite way, so this is invariant. K is invariant, so all these terms is invariant. V is also invariant, psi is a constant, all this is invariant. So this is completely trivial. This is the first non-trivial case. W is invariant because phi has charge zero. So W is invariant. But D2 theta is not invariant. But D2 theta has to transform in the same way in the opposite way as Y, such that the combination Y D2 theta is invariant. So that's why I assign a charge two to Y and minus one to theta. So minus one, plus two. Okay? It's as simple as that. So it's not complicated. Now we can see for W. W, it has charge one. So W alpha has charge two. X has no charge, so this behaves as Y. Charge two cancels the charge minus one of this. Okay? So we check that this is a symmetry of our Lagrangian, of our axiom. We are assigning. We say, well, we are looking for a symmetry where that this is, and then we say, well, if they have charge zero, we can get everything is invariant. So, yes. Another way to say that we're looking for symmetries that were not there before. Yes. Oh, that's precisely it. Yes, remember that a field transforms like e to the I alpha times the charge.
Yeah, right.
Yes, so that depending on the charge, that tells you what is the phase that is being transformed. So a field of charge one has only one phase. If it has charge two, the phase is twice that. So very, very good. So this is telling us. So y goes to e to the 2i alpha times y, whereas theta goes like e to the minus I alpha times theta. Okay, that this is the charge. The 2 is the charge, and this minus 1 is the charge. Good. So far, so good. So this is the first new symmetry that is there because we introduce this new field y. There is another symmetry that is called a Peche-Quinn symmetry. Okay. Both Peche and Quinn may be surprised that we use their name for this kind of a object because they introduced this symmetry for completely different purposes many years ago before any knowledge of a supersymmetry. And the idea is as follows. The Peche-Quinn symmetry, who knows about the Peche-Quinn symmetries? Only one, okay. Good. The Peche-Quinn symmetry is a very simple symmetry that in this case, every field is invariant except for x, where x is shifted to x plus I times a real constant. Okay. This is telling us that the real part of x is invariant, but the imaginary part of x is shifted by R. Okay? Why is this a symmetry? This is straightforward. Why? Because in the x w alpha, this will have, if you write this in components, you will have the real part of x times f mu, plus the imaginary part of x times f mu tilde. And if I shift the imaginary part of x by a constant, the only thing I get is ff dual times a constant. But ff dual is a total derivative. So the action will be invariant. Okay. Okay. So in this sense, x this little x, which is the scalar component of the superfield x, behaves like an action field. Okay, so this was the original reason that Peche-Quinn introduced the symmetry, because you introduce a new particle xx that has precisely this symmetry, and that play a role. As an attempt, is the best way to solve what is called the strong CP problem in the standard model. So, and this will be a new field that you introduce to the standard model, and that has some implications, like it's candidate for dark matter and so on. In this case, for us, X is not a physical field, so we don't have to worry about those implications. But that's just to give you the historical context where Peche-Quinn introduced the symmetry. And so here we have it. So this symmetry is very important. Now, this was the main symmetry that Witten used, for instance, when he proved the normalization theorem for string models. Okay, so for symmetries, we have that. And so let's see, what do we learn from the symmetries? X is this, all the other ones are small. Because the axion is just a scalar particle, so is the first component of so the axion has nothing to do with supersymmetry, for instance. So it's just a Good. So now we know that this is a symmetry, because this is the only field that feels it, and the only effect that it has is in this derivation. Okay. So so how can we use now these symmetries to find the quantum corrections? So first I have to write for you the most general quantum corrected action. So and for you, this I will use to be a bit more precise, this is what is called the Wilsonian action. Which is different from the 1PI action that you have. That you have heard about. I'm sure you have seen this one particle irreducible action that you. Sorry?
I don't know,
1PI. 1PI. You haven't heard the 1PI?
Yeah.
Yes, one particle irreducible, yes. One particular reducible action that you get by the standard procedure of Legendre transforming and so on, but the Wilsonian action is different. So this is, of course, I won't tell you the whole picture here. It will be a full field theory lecture, but it's just the Wilsonian action is following the, what Wilson had in mind, that you have you integrate out momenta up to the given cutoff, and this that will give you is the cutoff is the effective action up to a given energy. Okay, so in that sense, I will have S, and I will put lambda, where lambda is a cutoff, and that means that I have integrated all momenta up to this cutoff in my path integral. Okay. And this, of course, will be as a function of x and y. Then, in principle, if we do everything in a supersymmetric manner, so then the Lagrangian still will be supersymmetric and still can be written as in the most general supersymmetric form in terms of carrier potentials and so on. But now, this will be. Instead of the Keller, the Keller potential, I will now call it J to show you that it's different from the original K. K was a three-level one. This will be different. And this can depend on everything you can imagine. On phi, phi dagger, e to the v's, x, x dagger, y, y dagger, and even derivatives of them. Covariant, supercovariant derivatives. Okay, so this is the messy part of the action, and unfortunately, I will not have that much to say about this. The Fayet-Leopoldus also can depend on the new fields, for instance. And all this. Is that plus then the holomorphic part of the action? It will be in general a function of phi's of x, y, and w alphas. Okay, so what we're saying is that after doing the renormalization procedure, we end up with a quantum action that is completely, we don't know anything about it. That's the thing that we will do in standard non-supersymmetric theories. We have is a corrected action, and we have to do the corresponding calculations to get an idea of what this action is. However, for n equals to 1 supersymmetry, using this these symmetries that I showed you that exist, and the fact that this function is holomorphic, notice that I only wrote phi's, x, and y's, not their daggers, because this is, as usual, is the chiral part of the Lagrangian. So we can say something about what is the general shape that these functions can take. Okay. So from using the symmetries, the U1R symmetry, we have to see how this constrains the terms in the Lagrangian. Okay. For J, which is very general, the only thing I can tell you is that, well, if you have y together with y dagger, y appears only as a product y by dagger to any power, it's always invariant. So that's the only constraint you have, is that y appears together with y dagger. But otherwise, you have an arbitrary function of y and y times y dagger. So it's not so much restricted. However, for h, we will concentrate on h, and this will give us more information. So let's concentrate on h. H has to be something that satisfies the symmetries, the R symmetry. And we know that the only thing that transform are Y and W. Okay? And they have charge 2 and 1. So that means that you can have, and since this already has the d2 theta, has already charge minus 2, you have to come out with something out of this that has charge plus 2. So what is it that you can write? It's just y times an arbitrary function of x and phi plus another arbitrary function that I call, say, g of x and phi times w alpha. Okay, because we know that x and phi do not transform, so any function will do it. But y carries the charge, and what w alpha also carries the charge. So this can be any other function. Okay, so that u1r restricts a lot our general h. I mean, it has to be linear in y and linear in w alpha to have this thing invariant. Okay, we can say more things. Here, now let's use from the Peshey-Quinn symmetry, which is usually called PQ. From the Peshey-Quinn symmetry, we know then that the only field that transforms is X, okay? And X transforms as a shift, which is important. So any power of x will not be invariant because it's a shift. So this restricts a lot what this function h can be. In particular, it tells you that h does not depend on x. And then this g of x and phi, still you will have a term just linear in x. I can just put the alpha, just a coefficient, plus a function only of phi, w alpha. Okay, so notice that we have reduced a lot the dependence. Now there is no dependence on x. So now this h is a function of phi, and this only depends on phi, and then there's the linear term in x. Okay. H cannot be linear in x because x, if you shift x by a constant, that will give you something that is not invariant. Whereas in here, if you shift x by a constant, the transformation will give you an FF dual, which is a total derivative. Yes, good question. But I think did you see that? So any dependence on x here is forbidden because x plus a constant to any power will give you something which is not invariant. Whereas here, a linear is allowed because still you have the Pecci-Quinn symmetry there. Okay, so this is as much as we can get using these two symmetries so far. Now, look at what we are getting out. We're getting a Lagrangian, the d2 theta part, instead of this completely arbitrary thing, now we have something linear in y, something linear in x, plus this term. Okay, so it's starting to look very similar to the Lagrangian we started with, which is this one. Something linear in y, something linear in x. Okay, so we are almost there. Now take the limit. And the limits that I told you is x going to zero. Sorry, x going to infinity. And y go to zero. So you take the limit y to be very small, that's telling you that this piece looks like the superpotential part, okay? And in the y goes to zero case, you are disconnecting all the couplings, all the self-couplings of the superpotential. So that means that the only thing that you are left is the three-level superpotential. So this implies that h of phi equals 2 w of phi is the superpotential at tree level. And this is a big exclamation sign. This is one of the most important results in supersymmetry. This is telling you that the superpotential at tree level, notice that h is playing the role of the corrected superpotential. Now, in this limit, we are telling you that because we can take the limit y goes to zero, the only value that h can take is just the three-level superpotential. And so we have proven that the superpotential is not renormalized at any order in perturbation theory. So this is how strong these arguments can be. The same thing can be done for x. Because now this thing is the correction to the gauge kinetic function. The gauge kinetic function we started only with being x, but now we have x plus this. So the only thing I want you to get convinced is that this thing will be the tree level part and this will be the one loop part. And then there will not be any other corrections. And that will be showing you that the gauge kinetic function doesn't get corrections beyond one loop. So let me just try to see this. Okay. So just to keep in mind, because this is so important, so So the Gauss kinetic function, now we'll take the corrected one. I told you it looks like, so I have it like alpha x plus g of phi. This is the loop corrected. So what I will try to show you is that, to illustrate to you at least, is that this is tree level. And again, when the things decouple, that will tell you that alpha will be equal to 1. So that means that this will be just our starting point. And this will be one loop. Okay. So let's see how this goes. Notice that from the starting point, notice that gauge propagators, gauge field propagators, they go, remember that since the gauge coupling is x f mu nu f mu nu, so the propagator goes like 1 over x. It's the inverse of the kinetic term. Remember, when you have for a massless scalar, d mu phi, d mu phi, the propagator goes like 1 over p squared. It's the inverse. D mu phi is pp phi. The propagator goes like 1 over that. Okay. So in this case, x is the thing that multiplies f mu nu. So 1 over x is the propagator. You look very confused. I can write that down, yes. So gauge coupling. Goes like x. Let me just be more, well, f mu nu. And this goes like x d mu a nu. So when you get propagator, you get inverse powers of this object, so you will get the 1 over x here. Okay? Remember, propagator goes like 1 over momentum, and d are the momentum. So you have the coupling x, the propagator will come with the 1 over x. No? Yes, of course. But we're counting powers, that's the thing. Yes. Oh, thank you. Yes. Yes. Very good. That may have been confused. I'm only counting powers of x. So that's the only thing I'm telling you. But also, gauge couplings, gauge self couplings, like they come with power x, because again, in x f mu nu f mu nu, you will have an x a or something. So you will have the power x. You have x multiplying the vertex. The vertex will come in x times thing of a or d a in the. Okay. So that means that number of powers of x in arbitrary diagrams will be equal to what? To the number of vertices that I will call W for the gauge field, number of vertices for W minus the number of internal lines for the gauge field again. Okay? The internal lines are the propagators. This is an internal line and this is a vertex. Okay? So whenever you hit a propagator, you have a factor of 1 over x. Whenever you hit a vertex, you have a power of positive x. That's the only thing I'm saying. So, but we also know that the number of loops, and that I think you have seen in your advanced quantum field theory course, the number of loops L goes like I minus V plus 1. I think you have seen that in counting the number of loops in an arbitrary diagram. Yeah. And so that means but I minus V is equal to minus NX. So that means that this means that NX equals to 1 minus the number of loops. OK? So that's it. So that means that for NX equal, for L equal to 0, that means tree level, this implies NX equal to 1. That means that we have the power of X is equal to 1. And this tells us what I was promising you, that this is the tree level result. OK? And in particular, since it is the tree level, that means at the end, I'm getting just the tree level results, and the alpha equals to 1. But for L equals to 1, we have the one loop. And that tells us NX equals to 0. 1 minus 1 is 0. And that's precisely the term G phi. OK. So this is telling you that, precisely that. So the loop corrected. So loop corrected gauge coupling is just X plus, in principle, a function of the phis. Okay. So where this is, again, this is tree, and this is one loop. Okay. I'm taking this argument, most of, this argument is coming from Weinberg's chapter 27.8 or something. And he still goes on and insists that G has to be a constant. That's because he's restricted to the renormalizable case. And in that case, you say, well, there's an extra rule that in the renormalizable case, there are as many phis as phi daggers. So if you don't have phi daggers here, you cannot have phis. But in general, for instance, I know from string theory that there are corrections to the gauge couplings that are field dependent, especially if these fields are chargeless. So, okay. So, and to finish, what happened to, as I told you, the Keeler potential gets all corrections because it's not restricted by holomorphicity. So look at the reason that the Keeler potential gets corrected . The only restriction that we found is that J, when it depends on Y, it depends on Y and Y dagger. And when it depends on X, it depends only on the real part of X. But besides that, it can get any correction. So that means that we don't get that much information about the corrections to the Keeler potential. So that means that it gets corrected to all orders. So we have three other results. The only thing that we are is what the Fayette-Leopoulos term. In general, psi would be a function of the fields that I introduce. Times the corresponding vector field of U1. But gauge invariance and supersymmetry, gauge invariance, which in this sense is V goes to I lambda minus lambda dagger, implies that psi has to be a constant. So any dependence on chiral superfields, it will destroy this invariance. That's actually our original argument why we had to have something constant times the vector superfield. Anything else will not be gauge invariant. So psi is a constant, but it's not necessarily the same constant as we started with. So this is the, and the only contributions that it can get, it can only get contributions which are from diagrams. So you say, which kind of diagrams can give you contributions that give you xi equals to a constant? And these diagrams happen to be this type of diagrams, which are called tadpoles. But this is gauge. And these are, in the loop, there are all the fermions. OK? These ones are the ones, because this in these vertices do not depend on x or y, so anything on the gauge couplings. Notice that x and y do not appear on the Keter potential on k. So the couplings of psi to a's, which appear in the gauge in the covariant derivatives, they do not depend on x or y. So this is the only kind of diagrams that will contribute to corrections that will give you something constant. But this happens to be proportional to the sum of all the charges, or is it called the trace of the charge of the corresponding U1, where the charges correspond to the charges of the of all the fermions in your theory. And if you have a theory where the corresponding U1 has a non-zero trace, then this theory is inconsistent. It's inconsistent because it has something. I will finish in 1 second, sorry. Just to, if trace of Q is different from zero, the theory is inconsistent in the sense that it has what is called gravitational anomalies. Don't be scared by this, I just tell you what it is. Gravitational anomalies is when you have couplings of this type, when this is a graviton, this is a graviton, these are matter fields, and then these are the gauge fields. So these are the psi's, this is g mu nu's, and this is the a mu's. Okay? This theory, whenever you see a triangle diagram like this, be scared, because then the theory can be inconsistent. So you have seen anomalies in field theory? Not yet. Well, you will see, and you will not forget them. Okay. So for instance, the standard model is anomaly-free, and you have to compute all these kind of diagrams, all the triangular diagrams, and they have to cancel. In particular, this diagram where you have gravitons coming in the two external legs and only one gauge boson coming here, this is also proportional to the trace of Q. And if this is different from zero, implies that you're breaking gauge invariance by this loop corrections. And so that is bad. So that tells you that if you don't have a theory where you don't have a gravitational anomalies, then this also are zero, and then your Fagiolopoulos is not corrected. Okay? So that means that if there are no gravitational anomalies, this implies that the Fagiolopoulos term is not corrected.
Does the name come from the breaking of the equivalence of inertial and gravitational mass?
Actually, no. The gravitational anomalies is because you have anomalies are always whenever you have a triangle diagram and you can have here all gauge fields, for instance. That would be an anomaly. And when you have gravitons as two of your external legs, that's why it's called gravitational, because two of the external legs are gravitational. So what this breaks, actually, it will break perturbatively the gauge symmetry. And that's because it's an anomaly. The gauge symmetry would be, whenever these diagrams with some external legs, at least one of them is a gauge theory, is a gauge field, so it will break the corresponding gauge symmetry. And you have to check, for instance, in the standard model, it's a beautiful check. Take all the particles of the standard model and compute the charges, the U1 charges, and the hypercharge charges of them, and add them all together, and magically you will get trace of Q equal to zero. So that's a beautiful thing. Okay, so this is non-trivially consistent.
Okay.
Okay, so this finishes the proof, so we are in good hands.